Hey, everybody. Welcome to On the Sidelines with Hagan and Hunter. I'm Seth Hagan.
I'm Hunter Price.
And we're glad that you've joined us here on a Monday night. We know we're right up against the NBA Finals, so you definitely want to get to that. But we're going to give you our NBA Finals preview along with a few other things. We're going to talk about some college football. Got to shout out the Auburn Tiger softball team for getting for national runner-up. They were there. They did not come away with the win, but they sure scared the heck out of the Sooners there for a little bit. Biggest comeback of all time in Women's College World Series history. And shook the whole foundation of the earth, really. I mean, they might be too much?
A little too much.
Okay. Well, probably. But, I mean, it was fantastic. And it also included this awesome highlight from the Auburn center fielder. Look at this grab.
The golden retriever herself.
Oh, I mean, what an insane catch. I mean, full extension. I mean, this Auburn team, I believe she's coming back next year. This Auburn team is just chock full of talent and really looking forward to seeing what Clint Myers has got.
What about the other catch?
The other catch at the wall, that's right.
That's the one that won the game.
That's right. Because she got that one at the wall.
That was crazy. Against Arizona.
Yes. That wasn't in the championship.
That wasn't against Oklahoma in game two.
That run.
Where the girl turned into Andrew Jones.
Yeah, she went right up over the wall. The leadoff girl.
Boop. Brought it back.
Man, it was one heck
Tiffany
of a run
Howard.
For Auburn. So we wanted to recognize that any state programs in the area that are doing well, we want to shout out them first because those are our people. Like I said, want to talk about some NBA Finals because it is coming up here in the next little bit. Really excited to get to the action. I mean, it's going to be, I think, a tight one. Mm-hmm. Draymond Green is out. If you didn't hear about that earlier, bit of a game changer considering that the guy, after game two, was leading the team in points, rebounds, assists, and steals. I mean, that's insane. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, the Cavs shut down the Splash Brothers the last time we saw you guys, but boy, did they ever come alive in that game four on the road when they needed it. I believe Steph Curry had 38, Klay Thompson with 25, hit a bunch of threes. Team hit 17 threes, an NBA Finals record, yet another record for this team after they won their 88th game, which is kind of a stupid record, I think. Because it's like, well, yeah, they play one more game in the first round. So, yeah, I guess they're going to get the most wins ever, you know. But that's kind of, I don't know, it's kind of stupid to me.
Sure.
But whatever.
Sure.
Yes, we'll live and let live.
They got the most wins in regular season.
I'm going to lose my mind.
Of course they're going to have the most wins in the playoffs.
Yeah, of course. And, that the ball rolls on. But what are your thoughts on tonight? Because we were talking about it in the car on the ride over, and I'm just not feeling the Cavs in this one, even in a close one. I just don't think they're a good enough of a road team, and Draymond Green doesn't do enough scoring for Golden State for me to really have to worry about them on this one.
Yeah, but he does a lot on the defensive end when it comes to defense and rebounding.
That has me worried.
And just Draymond's Green antics, he doesn't to get into players' heads.
Yeah.
But you saw into LeBron's head.
And again, he disappears down the stretch.
So I think it's going to be interesting to see, do the Warriors come out, fired up, and just blow the Warriors and blow the Cavs away? Or does the Warriors kind of struggle a little bit with getting things going on offense without Draymond Green?
Right.
Because the offense doesn't flow through Draymond Green.
But he does bring energy and effort to the team.
He's definitely a huge part of the offense.
Yes.
You know, the ball comes down. He's your trailer. Mm-hmm. He trails, and it comes to him, and Steph goes to the corner. He comes off a down screen. Well, he goes to the corner. Klay comes off a down screen. The ball goes to Klay. That down screen rolls, and then Draymond usually follows his pass and sets a screen for Klay.
Yep. A lot of people make a big deal about the Warriors' death squad lineup. And that is where Draymond Green moves to the five spot, which shows you his versatility. The guy can handle the ball, can shoot from the outside. Oh, and by the way, he can play center on your team as well. So but that is the age in basketball that we live in. Now that he is out, it looks like Andre Iguodala and Harrison Barnes will be asked to step up in this one. What are your thoughts in that area?
Well, I don't.
Who else may step up?
Who else? Maurice Spates.
Spates, for sure.
I think Spates is going to step up. I think Varejao and Bogut. I think Varejao is going to be key.
Yeah, he was big in Cleveland. Mm-hmm. You know, that's got to be a real shot to the gut, because a guy that was with your team for a decade plus ends up closing you out on his old home floor. Mm-hmm. What a moment for Anderson Varejao to get those offensive rebounds and keep the Cavs from coming back.
I don't think it's going to be one guy, because I don't think one guy can step up to replace what Draymond Green does. I think it's just going
to it will have to be.
Going to be a team effort by the Warriors bench to step up and replace Draymond.
And boy, have they ever in this series. And you're talking about a team that is overall, I believe they are outscoring the Cavs in this series by 70 points.
The Warriors have the deepest.
They were up 45 after
the Warriors
first
have
two
the
games.
Deepest bench in the league. They should be outscoring them by that much.
Yeah, but you think.
And I mean, I'm sorry, but the Cavs bench is overrated. Yeah.
You're right. J.R. Smith is not. He's only had one pretty good game. He had 20 points in game three. Did not follow that up. Followed it up in the worst way possible. Check this out. 24 minutes. Did not record a single statistic.
That's J.R. Smith for you.
Show up here, disappear there.
That's J.R. Smith for you. That's
Magic
why
show.
That's why I'm never going to pick a team with J.R. Smith, in it to win a championship.
Oh, man. I mean, I don't think he affects the team that much, but
I think he does, because you look at how Draymond Green affects the team so much in the things he does.
Okay, it's vice versa. It's a mindset.
And then you let LeBron let his emotions get the best of him.
Yeah, he did.
And why LeBron
didn't?
That was
too bad.
LeBron was at fault for why Draymond.
LeBron has never been a clutch player ever. Ever in his life, at least in the finals, and
when it
came down to the nitty gritty, he's not the guy to make your game winning shot. He's not that guy.
He should get some blame for Draymond being suspended. I mean, LeBron fouled. LeBron threw him on the ground and then stepped over him slowly.
And then basically pandered afterwards in the post game interviews, like, oh well, he called me a name and I'm a man with pride, and you don't do stuff like that.
And then Klay Thompson turns around and goes,
get real, man. This is a man's game.
Klay Thompson then says,
trash talk.
Klay Thompson then says, oh, I guess he just got his feelings hurt.
Yeah.
And LeBron laughs and goes, well, I'm just going to take the high road, which if you say I'm taking the high road, I don't think you're really taking the high road.
Yeah, because you're letting everybody know,
what Steph Curry's
wife
said?
You're down 3-1. No, I didn't.
She said, the high road, period. The invisible bridge that you go to go over someone instead of going left of the open court or right of the open court.
Oh, no. Chef Curry's wife is savage. The woman is savage. Oh, with the zinger. With the zinger.
Yes.
Oh, boy. Now, I mean, LeBron's going to lose this series. It's just whether or not he's going to lose a second straight finals in five games to the same team and with supposedly a better roster. With his best players with him now at full strength. Now there are no excuses. Where does his career go from here? Does it turn into a joke? What do they do? I mean, I heard stuff about Kevin Love being traded for Carmelo Anthony today.
I saw you say that's interesting. I think that's a stupid trade.
Yeah, it's interesting, though.
You got Porzingis. What do you need Kevin Love for?
Because you make Kevin Love the featured offensive player.
No.
Porzingis is not your featured offensive
player. He's going to be. You grow your team around Porzingis.
But not now. And Carmelo's window is closed.
No,
he has to be a supplementary part now. He can no longer be the feature.
You trade Melo, but you don't trade him for Love. You're not going to win with Love.
Okay, Love plus you get Iman Shumpert back? Like, I mean, what would it take?
You're not going to win with Love.
Exactly.
You trade Melo for the top.
But the Knicks are stupid.
You trade
Melo.
You trade Melo for a couple of role players in the top pick in the draft. You get Chris Dunn.
Well, I know how much you love Chris Dunn, but
or Buddy Hield.
I just don't think that one guy. And here's the thing about the Knicks: they don't have a first round pick this year.
That's why you trade Melo for a couple of role players and one of the top five picks in the draft.
Well, I mean, you got to make that move in the next couple weeks.
You go get Buddy Hield or Chris Dunn.
those would be the ones that would make the biggest difference, for sure.
They are. I don't see Ben Simmons being that difference maker, or
not in New York.
No. Who's the other guy?
Let's see. He's the tall guy.
Duke.
Right? The guy. Ingram.
Yeah, Brandon Ingram. You don't need any of them. You got Porzingis.
Yeah.
I go get Chris Dunn or Buddy Hill. And then some quality bench or role players.
Maybe Dunn over Hield, because I feel like he is a franchise point guard. Whereas, you know, I mean, you already have a franchise type of
Chris Dunn's player.
And he's just going to make it easier.
Chris Dunn's the next Chris Paul.
You think so?
Yeah. Watch him.
Heard it here first, everybody.
Chris Dunn is the next Chris Paul.
From Providence.
Yeah, he is. They both wear number 3, too.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. You can tell he is more of a scorer than Chris Paul, but he kind of mirrors his game after him.
Oh, very much so. He plays some hard defense, too.
Word. Well, we're actually going to talk about the NBA draft a little bit later on in the show, but we do have to take a break. So let you all know what we got coming up. We're going to talk about another way too early top 25 poll. Mark Schlabaugh of ESPN released his very last one. He also, a couple days later, released his consensus, like All-American preseason team. Going to check and see if anybody from Auburn or Alabama is on that list. Kind of discuss that. Also going to talk a little bit more about the NBA Finals as we go along. And from there, we'll see what happens. So everybody stick around. On the Sideline returns in just a moment.
At Premier Bank, you have a financial partner you can depend on. Hi, I'm Jay Mullins, president of Premier Bank, with some exciting news about our financial strength and performance. For the 6th consecutive year, our bank has been rated 5 stars by Bauer Financial, an independent firm that has been analyzing and reporting on the financial condition of the nation's banking industry since 1983. This prestigious rating means that we are one of the strongest banks in the nation, and a safe and sound bank you can depend on.
Moe's Original Barbecue, where you'll find award-winning Bama-style pulled pork, racks of ribs, and chicken smoked fresh daily over hardwood, served with 2 unique sauces, plus 8 to 10 traditional sides and tasty desserts. Moe's opens daily at 11 a.m., serving lunch and dinner until it's all gone. There's also a full premium bar with plenty of TVs for sports viewing and live music. Moe's Original Barbecue offers large party takeout orders, catering, and delivery. Moe's Barbecue, a unique all-things Southern barbecue experience.
The 2016 Fiat 500X has arrived, and it's ready to drive at Fiat of Huntsville. This perfectly bold crossover is impressively equipped with a turbocharged engine, seating for 5, available all-wheel drive, and just $249 a month or $4,000 off. Plus, you get customizable amenities like 5 different trim levels to perfectly match your style. Come experience the all-new Fiat 500X at Fiat of Huntsville or online at FiatUSAofHuntsville.com, a Frank Williams dealership.
Everybody, welcome to On the Sidelines. I'm Seth Hagan.
I'm Hunter Price.
And we are Hagan and Hunter.
I got some big news, by the way. One of my best friends.
Hit me with it.
Just got engaged today.
Very cool.
Breaking news.
Very cool.
This guy.
It is the season of love.
This guy, he's a pretty big deal in Alabama, by the way. A lot of people know him. Breaking news here on the Sidelines.
It's kind of a big deal.
Andy Instagram has just gotten engaged to Desiree Strickland. 2 years ago today, they went on their first date to a wedding, and now they are engaged.
The first date was a wedding?
Yep.
Oh, well, that was a telltale sign.
Yep.
I would have put money on that. I think I'm playing.
They fell in love at a worship conference. They were both playing.
Oh, cool.
And then they made eye contact while worshiping Jesus.
Is that the story? That's like the legit story?
Yeah.
Nicholas Sparks should like write a book about him.
That's
a little too perfect, man.
They made
it's
eye
a little
contact.
Too perfect. There'll be at least
it
a.
It was history.
I guess so.
But congrats to Andy. Congrats to Andy. I'm pretty excited.
Yeah.
You know, cool. All my friends are going off, getting engaged, getting married.
Yeah, mine too.
And
was just at a wedding.
My friend Scott Huggins got engaged 2 weeks.
Was in a wedding.
My friend Scott Huggins got engaged 2 weeks ago to my friend Morgan Dow, and then my buddy Russ got engaged 4 or 5 weeks ago to our friend Christy.
Yeah.
Dude, it's all my close friends are getting engaged, and I'm sitting here like, do I get an
what
account?
What are we supposed to do?
I'm sitting here like, do I get an account in eHarmony or do I not get an account in eHarmony?
Eesh. Man. I don't like to pay for dating sites.
I don't either. I'm not gonna do it.
I think that's kind of crazy. You're already paying for the date in the man's case most of the time, so you know you're basically budgeting for like, you know, $500 of dating money every year. Like that's ridiculous. Like, and you throw in
it was
like,
a joke.
Like
I'm not gonna do it.
Well, I know. I'm just saying like it's complicated. I haven't thought about it at all.
It's just a joke. My time will come.
Right.
I'm not worried about it.
Both of our times are coming at some point.
Are they?
Hello, future Mrs. Hagen. Wherever you are. All right. Hurry up. All right. Like I said, before we ended our first segment on the program.
You found a gray hair today. You really need to hurry
up. Oh, my God. You traitor.
Hurry up or he's going to be a silver fox before you know it.
Silver fox. Like some...
So
some,
on tour, like, way too like, early, top
like
25.
George Clooney. Louisville Cardinals are... Start off the top 25, way too early top 25 that was released by ESPN. Louisville, a team that got better as the year went along, lost to Auburn, lost to Houston to start the year. But both those teams would prove to be pretty good at the end of the season, even though Auburn had their struggles, of course. They'll lose Sheldon Rankins, guy who got, you know, pretty much a tackle for loss every time he stepped on the field. Guy was fantastic. I believe he went in the early second round of the NFL draft. And, I mean, that's a steal because this guy can play inside, outside. He's fantastic. And right now, Lamar Jackson looks like a guy who's got a really high ceiling, especially with Bob Petrino putting him in the right spots. I think it's a pretty good, well-deserved spot in the top 25. Mm-hmm. I mean, as far as the ACC goes, and we know it's pretty much shallow every year. It's a basketball conference. So Louisville has that chance to automatically get up there with the Florida States and the Clemsons and now the North Carolinas. North Carolina, a team that we may see on this top 25 list, but we shall not reveal. What do you think about Louisville?
I think that's a solid top 25. It seems like that's where they are every year.
Yeah, they're kind of hovering, but they never quite go all in.
Just you know like I mean? Their sponsor, Papa John's, it's pretty good, but just it's delivery.
You're hating on Papa John's.
It's delivery.
Man. I love Papa John's.
I do too, but I mean, it's not as good as going to like.
Yeah, probably.
Chicago Deep Style.
Chicago Deep Style.
That's the best pizza ever, man.
Dude.
At number 24, we have the Miami Hurricanes, and I'm torn about this one. I don't know if I agree with this one. And I'm torn because, man,
Brad Kaya is pretty awesome. He's kind of like Lamar Jackson in that same kind of high ceiling, but we just don't know yet type
of
mode.
He's got a neck the size of a giraffe.
And, boy, did they lose a lot to the NFL in their senior class. Did not see that. And of course, you know, starting out with a new coach, it is Mark Richt. So I do expect them to get about 8 wins.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, you're right. Top 25, it may not be time for that.
Is 8 wins enough for the top 25 for Miami, though?
Probably not, considering where they are in their conference, you know.
And number 23, guess who we have?
Oh, the winners of the Big 12 West of last year.
The Iowa Hawkeyes. And I don't see them doing this again. I don't see them going 12-12.
No, like they'll sneak up on you every few years, but after that, you can pretty much regulate them to the cellar. Sorry, Hawkeyes fans. I know a ton of you watch this show. But just doesn't seem to be in the cards. I think they kind of got this ranking out of respect for last year and on the off chance that maybe they've got something brewing there. But
losing their running back. They're losing their tight end, their wide receiver, their star defensive end. Drew Ott was denied a 6-year of eligibility.
Yeah, I heard about that, and that hurts. That hurts. The captain of your defense.
I don't see that. And number 22, The UCLA Bruins.
Okay. I can see that. I can see that.
They're not losing a lot.
Not a ton.
Josh Rosen. Got right. a little mouth on him.
Really?
Yeah, he does.
What has he been like, posting internet videos?
He wore
such?
An F. Trump hat to Trump's golf course. He played.
I mean,
he got
if you're in, on Trump's golf course.
He got invited to Donald.
They probably
invited,
convinced me too.
He got invited to Trump's, play Trump's golf course, and you wore an F. Trump hat.
Oh, an F. Trump hat.
Yeah.
Oh.
And what's his name? He just signed a new contract deal. The head coach.
I guess he's a little Manziel in there, just a little brash, disregard for authority.
That's what his coach was telling him. He's like, you can do this stuff and end up like Manziel. Or you can keep your mouth shut, focus on football.
Yeah, and be continue like Peyton, to be the guy that you are.
And be like Peyton Manning or Tom Brady. You don't see them guys
Rosen had a freshman year for the ages. I mean, came in and did not miss a beat. Like, the kid was nailing it from the get-go. A guy like I think that Jacob Eason could be just as good.
It's going to be interesting,
but
though.
It's different because it's a different level of competition.
UCLA replaces three offensive linemen, and they lost their top three wide receivers.
Okay.
Is that going to be an issue?
The quarterback is just so much more important than the receivers.
At number 21. Well, I think the offensive line.
At the college level.
I think the offensive line is more important than the quarterback.
No doubt.
And they lost three of those. You only have five, and you lose three.
Ooh.
Yeah, exactly. So is Josh Rosen going to be able to do enough to replace that?
Right. Speaking of teams that lose a lot of offensive linemen just about every year, the Texas A&M Aggies come in at number 21. A lot of people were predicting this team to go into the cellar. And Kevin Sumlin was quoted this week saying that he loves the fact that nobody thinks they're worth a dang. And hey, that's he's right. Nobody's giving him credit. They're not giving John Chavis credit. And those are two of the best minds in their respective craft on offensive defense that there are in this business, at least at the college level. So, and you know how disrespect in the offseason can rile a team and raise their level of play.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be interesting. Trevor Knight is going to be coming.
I would have put Auburn in front of Texas A&M. Like, I mean, come on. Texas A&M only has one real proven defensive player.
You got a new quarterback, new offensive coordinator, Trevor Knight quarterback, and old ex-Auburn offensive coordinator, Noel Mazzone.
Yeah.
Coming in on the offense. Yeah. That's going to be interesting.
Yes, it will.
You do have two locked-down All-Americans in Miles Garrett and Deshaun Hall, and then you got Dylan Mack, see what he can do in year two.
Yeah, Dylan Mack, yeah.
I'll be glad to see Miles Garrett leave after this year. That guy can play.
Yes, he is.
He's a Von Miller type player.
Yeah, we'll be definitely seeing him on Sundays, and a surefire first round pick if he continues this kind of production. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's led the SEC in sacks last year, and fully expect him to do the same, if not better. Just a question of whether Jonathan Allen beats him from Alabama, Carl Lawson from Auburn. There's a lot of guys every year, or maybe somebody out of the blue from Missouri.
Carl Lawson was only second team SEC.
Only second team. Yeah. Interesting. I love that.
I think Miles Garrett and Deshaun Hall were the two first team.
Wow. Okay.
But I would have put Carl Lawson up above them. At least Deshaun Hall.
Yeah. Yeah, Deshaun Hall. Yeah, like that's and interesting Miles, that think, they gave I, them that much
I
credit.
I don't know if Deshaun Hall was up there. I know Miles Garrett was, but even I think Carl Lawson does more for the defense than Miles Garrett. I think Miles Garrett's a great pass rusher, but I think Carl Lawson's a type that not only rushes a pass, but plugs the holes.
Yeah, I think everybody's just kind of holding off him because we haven't had a lot of him over the last 2 years to really know if he's really going to be that guy or if he's just going to continue to get hurt.
I think he's that guy. It's just if he can stay healthy.
Yeah, Auburn fans and SEC fans, but overall it's hard to.
Number 20. The TCU Horned Frogs.
I don't know about this.
They're only returning three on offense. They're returning seven on defense.
Three on offense and number 20 in the nation?
Replacing their quarterback.
That's a debilitating number. Like, you better hope that Gary's got some numbers.
Yeah, they're
at TCU, man.
Replacing Josh Dawson.
Not easy.
Replacing Josh Dawson, replacing Trayvon Boykin.
They're basically responsible for your entire offense.
Yeah, LSU transfer, John D'Arce. And they got two JUCO wide receivers coming in. Taj Williams, that name sounds familiar. Where was he? Taj Williams, where was he at?
I'm not sure, but you're right, it does sound familiar.
That sounds familiar, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Number 19.
Oregon. Oregon. The Ducks will have another transfer quarterback. Could be Montana State's grad transfer, Dakota Prukop. Or redshirt freshman, Travis Johnson.
I think you go with the redshirt freshman and start building something.
That would be better for them in the long term. Mm-hmm. You don't want to continue to get caught up in the
Can you tell me who their new defensive coordinator is?
No, I can't. Who is it?
Brady Hoke.
No kidding.
Mm-hmm.
Brady Hoke reemerges from the smoke. Mr. Hoke. Hopefully he's got some hocus pocus. He's not hoking and poking around.
And this thing about Oregon is they're replacing five linemen and linebackers. But the thing that's interesting about them is I feel like they just let their players play where they want to play. Charles Nelson is now focused on playing wide receiver, their safety from last year.
Wow. I mean, they just recruit a ton of athletes. And, you know, we've seen guys go from offense to defense all the time. So
it feels like that's his decision and not the team's. Like, you know, I think I'm going to switch from safety to wide receiver. No, how about you shut up, sit down, and do what's best for the team?
So they let him basically
That's what it sounds like to me. He is now focused on wide receiver.
Well, I don't know.
I feel like if the coaching staff was making the change, it would say the coaching staff has decided to switch him from safety to wide receiver.
My question in this situation is, did you, in fact, get minutes – at safety?
Yeah, he was their starting safety last year.
And now he's all of a sudden switching?
Yeah.
If that's your starting guy, like I wouldn't like Rudy Ford, going to wide receiver.
Well, he was a running back, so he switched.
Right, but it's not in his wheelhouse, so I don't know. I don't like
number
it.
Eight.
North Carolina
Tar Heels coming at number 18 in the way too early, top 25. They were 11-3 last year, 8-0 in the ACC. They lose Marquise Williams, and you're not going to know about anybody else because no one really knows about North Carolina, but you knew about Marquise Williams.
Yeah.
Are they going to be the same team as last year?
If they do, that would show that they truly have the ability to have some staying power. The Larry Fedora's really got something going there. I would be kind of iffy because they're in that kind of middle pack with Louisville and Miami, and I really think that Louisville has a higher ceiling.
Their backup last year, Mitch Trubisky completed 85.1% of his passes for 555 yards, 6 touchdowns, and no interceptions in backup last year.
Wow.
So, okay. But that's also in a backup role. Marquise Williams was out for a little bit, but not for much. I wonder, I'm going to have to call my buddy Blake Phillips and ask him about North Carolina Tar Heels. He's a big North Carolina fan.
Okay.
See what he says. Yeah, of course, he's going to say they're going to win it all, but.
Right.
We don't really take his opinion.
North Carolina, I don't know about all that.
Let's get one more.
Gene Chizik's really got them
involved.
Let's
get one more in before we go to break.
Okay.
Number 17, the Houston Cougars, who I think is going to upset Oklahoma week one.
I would not completely disagree with
13-1 in the last year, 7-1 in the AAC. They've got to do some AAC, ACC. This is not okay.
Yeah, it's awkward.
All-American
Athletic Conference is – very bland. If you're not familiar with what we're talking about, it's basically the former Big East, but mutated from that as well. And the Big East was always a hodgepodge of people who came in, left out, and that's what it's turned into. And Houston, the presumptive favorite in that conference, obviously.
Losing
a lot, including their head coach.
When you got Tom Hurt, they didn't lose their head coach.
Yeah, they did.
Tom Herman is there.
No, I'm talking about Memphis.
Oh, Memphis.
Memphis won't be contending with them.
Yes. You got Tom Herman come back, making the play calls. When you got a quarterback like Greg Ward Jr., that dude can play. I really
No doubt.
I don't expect any downfall from Houston this year. I think they're just going to turn around and keep it going like they're going. And just like that.
And probably better. I mean, they just landed their first five-star prospect ever in the offseason. So things looking up for Tom Herman's group.
He is.
All right, everybody. We're going to have the rest of the top 15 when we come back. Stay tuned.
The 2016 Fiat 500X has arrived, and it's ready to drive at Fiat of Huntsville. This perfectly bold crossover is impressively equipped with a turbocharged engine, seating for five, available all-wheel drive, and just $249 a month or $4,000 off. Plus, you get customizable amenities like five different trim levels to perfectly match your style. Come experience the all-new Fiat 500X at Fiat of Huntsville or online at fiatusaofhuntsville.com, a Frank Williams dealership.
My grandfather became a jeweler in 1944. My father opened Ed White Jewelers in 1961. And now I'm a third generation jeweler. Offering a wide variety of engagement rings and a large selection of loose diamonds, plus anniversary and baby gifts, have kept our customers coming back for generations. So shop where your grandmother shopped. She loved our quality and you will too. Shop Ed White Jewelers for the good stuff.
Everybody, welcome back to On the Sidelines. I'm Seth Hagan.
I'm Hunter Price.
And we are back for the second half of our show. We've just got done talking about some NBA finals and then the way too early top 25. We left off at number 17 on that list.
No, we left off. You're right.
We're going to move to 16.
Number 16.
You're so quick.
With this
to,
guy
to
might
judge.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I'm just
this might be the surprise
you.
Pick in the Pac-12.
Yeah.
The Washington Huskies under Chris Patterson going into his year two.
Yeah, they're putting a lot of
can he turn
faith
it around?
In him.
Can he turn it around?
I think so.
Can they win the Pac-12 North?
He's got a solid base there. I mean, pretty much anybody who doesn't go to Oregon or USC or UCLA really is going to go to Washington. They've got a good football tradition, so I think it's very possible. They played a lot of teams close last year. I remember they had a couple of upsets.
They played a lot of teams close.
If I'm not mistaken.
Played a lot of teams close, and that makes us move on to number 15 is another team who's played a lot of teams close and usually wins those close games. Michigan State Spartans.
Yep, Sparty.
They return only three guys on offense, six on defense. Connor Cook is gone.
Kind of expect them to take a step back.
You expect them to, but are they?
I think so, man. I
still
so.
See them as a 10-win team.
Just because of the Big Ten, or
yeah, just because of the foundation they've laid.
Okay, all right. So you just think that D'Antonio is somebody who's just going to stay there at the top,
yep,
and not really take a break, kind of like Urban Meyer. I mean, he was there before Urban Meyer, so I mean, no disrespect.
In a team
to
that's been there forever,
he's obviously very
a team
good.
That's been in the top 25 forever, but it's never done anything ever.
Ever
number 14, State Cowboys.
Cowboys.
I mean. They've been in the top 25 since Barry Sanders left. And
yeah.
They don't ever do anything.
They're always kind of there, but they don't finish the job.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's for a long time, Texas was keeping them down. Oklahoma really never left. Now you've got new teams in the
They only lose one guy on offense there.
That bodes well.
They only lose four on defense.
I like that. I like them. They could. There's a reason why they're in that top 15.
And, of course, Mike Gundy is still there. Well. Oh, my gosh, dude. He's been a man since he was 40, and what is he now, 55?
Yeah. Gosh, how long has it been since that rant?
I'm a man. I'm 40.
I mean, I think I was in college when he did that because that was, like, a big, like, it was, like, one of the first big, like, coach internet videos.
Oh.
They got shared a lot.
And guess who transferred to Oklahoma State this year? Eligible to play right away.
Oh, was it the kid who did Davis Webb end up going there? No? Okay.
It's a legend's son. Barry Sanders Jr.
Barry Sanders
Jr. is going to be at Oklahoma State.
The legacy has returned. Probably the greatest athlete to ever come out of Oklahoma State.
And you know what? This is what bothers me, all right? How they judge these stuffs off spring games. Sophomore defensive end Trey Carter had 3 sacks in the spring game. It's a spring game. You touch the guy, it's a sack.
Stop it. It's irresponsible.
ESPN, that's some irresponsible work on your part. Number 13,
come on, man.
I disagree with this one. I don't see it. I don't care that you have your quarterback returning and that he's all world. You're losing Treadwell. You're losing Tunzel. You're losing Kim Dichie.
Ole Miss does return. Chad Kelly had 8 300-yard games last year.
They're returning four guys on offense and four guys on defense.
Right. It's going to be tough, but it's worth mentioning that he has more 300-yard games than all of the returning quarterbacks in the SEC combined.
I don't care. A lot of that had to do with
– He is legit.
He's losing his left tackle. He's losing his blind side. He's losing Kim Dichie. He's losing Treadwell. He's losing Core.
They've always had a really deep wide receiver core, though. It was never just Treadwell. They've still got Evan Engram, I believe. I don't think that he's gone quite yet as their tight end. Because Arkansas lost their guy, he is the best in the country.
I don't see this Ole Miss team being –
I don't think they'll be that good either. I mean, people have them
picked. I think they're
going to
be
at least to number three.
A bottom tier top 25 team. And another one I disagree with, number 12, the Georgia Bulldogs. I don't agree
really
with this
high
one.
Expectations in Kirby Smart's
first year. I don't agree with this pick at all.
And I mean, we're talking about the only solid guys that you've got is Nick Chubb and that offensive line. But we saw last year that it gets old. Teams know how to prepare for just a good run game after a while. See Leonard Fournette in LSU if you don't believe me. I mean, you have to have multiple threats. And they lose their top pass catcher. We don't know who the quarterback is.
No.
That's up in the air completely. It could be a true freshman. I like Jacob Eason to come out of there. I just think he is. It would be great to get 3 years out of that guy.
I don't think Jacob Eason's going to be the one to come out of there. I think it's going to be Lambert. I feel like
gonna be Lambert again, but he really disappeared down the stretch.
He really didn't play that bad. He didn't have anybody around him.
When you lose Chubb and you can
pin your ears back and go straight for the quarterback and you have no playmakers on the outside. I never saw what the big deal was with Malcolm Mitchell. He never did anything.
No.
I don't know why people loved him. He never did anything, and yet was still drafted.
In the NFL draft, I was like, okay, well.
I'm sorry, Georgia's.
You've been talking about this guy for like 3 years.
I just don't see Georgia being number 12. At number 11, USC.
That's a courtesy ranking if I've ever seen one. You just want to get a potential top 10 matchup with Alabama. Let's just be real. We want a top 10 matchup first week of the season because it's the biggest blowout first week ever in college football history, and you want a top 10 matchup.
It's not a top 10 matchup because you're number 11.
Well, I'm saying that they want that. They're trying to push that.
They're returning nine guys on offense, 5 guys on defense.
Got to get a new quarterback, though.
They do, but they have one of the top high school quarterbacks.
And I don't know about Clay Helton. Shout out to him. Cool guy. But first year, not sure that he's going to just blow it out of the park. Certainly not top 15 worthy.
I don't see it. A team that I think should be in the top 5, and I think will be at the end of the year, at number 10, the Tennessee Volunteers. Good old Rocky Top. Hey, Rocky Top, Tennessee.
If they don't break through and win the East this year, when are you going
to
do it? What are you going
to
do, Butch? When are you going
to
do it, Butchie? I need to hear it from you.
Rocky Top, Tennessee.
Do it for Pat Summitt.
Do it for Pat.
Do it for somebody. Do it for your job,
Pat's
baby.
Pat's son did it for Pat
Summitt. Better watch out. I think Tennessee won't boot you. They gave Derek Dooley that courtesy year because of his father and because of Nick Saban and the coaching tree.
I think this is the year they do it. They're returning 9 on offense, 8 on defense.
That's what I'm saying. Like, if you don't do it this year, that team is going to get gobbled up by the NFL.
I think this is the year to do it.
Tennessee Volunteers.
Number 9, it's going to be a down team, but I don't know who steps up and replaces them in the Big 12. I mean, in Big 10. The Ohio State Buckeyes.
Yeah, they're pretty much perched up there on top. And despite losing a record number of players to the NFL draft.
Their only return is three.
They're still going to be there because they have more talent than the bottom half of the Big Ten.
They're only
combined.
Returning three on offense and three on defense. But
you still have to think that they're better than everybody else.
Other than Michigan and Michigan State.
Yeah, it really is Michigan's year to pounce.
It is.
Because Michigan State and Ohio State were both, you know, just taken advantage of by the NFL draft.
You got JT Barrett coming back, and he is the quarterback.
Oh, yeah, he's the man.
That's going to help them a lot.
Huge for the transition.
What they're going to do at running back, I don't know. Receiver, I don't know.
Urban's got guys waiting in the stable at running back.
They do.
I wouldn't worry about that. They are a fantastic team. Urban Meyer is one of the best in the game. And, you know, when he wins a championship, some people think that he is the best coach, but
Nick
Saban continues to come back.
Number eight, we got my dark horse national championship team.
Oh, you like Notre Dame, really?
Dark horse.
Interesting.
Not my pick. Just a dark horse to maybe come out and do it.
Right.
Yeah.
Got the talent to do it.
They do.
Without a doubt. But they got to replace Ronnie Stanley, their starting left tackle, and that's going to be big for their
Deshaun quarterback
Kizer, second
year. Malik Zaire, quarterback. Yep.
It's going to be Kizer, no doubt about it. Way bigger upside.
But
Zaire's pretty much lost the job to him. I wouldn't even worry about it. The only reason he's even sticking around is in case number one goes down.
You have the Admiral's son at wide receiver.
That's pretty cool. D. Rob's son Notre Dame.
David Robinson's son.
You see, that lets you know that David Robinson raises a class family.
Yep.
Son goes to Notre Dame, plays football. Man, I love David Robinson, man. Always loved and admired David Robinson.
Mm-hmm.
Never was scared to stand up for what he believed in.
At number seven.
Yeah.
Can you tell me who's at number seven?
No, I can't.
We got the Stanford Cardinals.
And you got to, even with Kevin Hogan going, you got to believe that that they have a real chance to take the Pac-12 this year.
It's going to be senior Ryan Burns or sophomore Keller Christ. From what they say, they didn't really show anything in the spring game, but who does show anything in the spring game?
Good point.
But they got the best player in college football returning.
Exactly. The should have been Heisman last year.
He should have been the Heisman last year.
It's amazing that the West Coast and the time that you play really affects the public. Half of the people on the Eastern Seaboard don't even see your games. In the Central time zone don't even see your games.
You're losing three stars offensive line, but I think Stanford probably wins the Pac-12. And before we go to break, number six, the LSU Tigers. I want to pick them, and then I want to look at them and say they're just going to be another 8-5 season. And then I want to say this has got to be a year Brandon Harris turns it around. This has got to be the year these guys get it together. They're returning 9 on offense. They're returning 9 on defense.
You know that you're pretty much playing for your coach's job.
Yeah, you got the whole year. You got Leonard.
The pressure is intense, and that's why I think
you got the best
break.
Running back in the SEC, maybe college football. You got probably the best wide receiver duo, Malachi Dupree and Trayvon Darrell. But can they do it?
I just think the pressure will be too much for them, even though the returning starters are stifling. 18 guys return, and that's after several years where LSU's roster was reamed by the NFL draft.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they lost some serious depth, and it's what's caused them to really falter from the top of the SEC West.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to get into the top five. Everybody stick around. We're going to have the top five and maybe a couple of other updates as well. Stick around.
The 2016 Fiat 500X has arrived, and it's ready to drive at Fiat of Huntsville. This perfectly bold crossover is impressively equipped with a turbocharged engine, seating for five, available all-wheel drive, and just $249 a month or $4,000 off. Plus, you get customizable amenities like five different trim levels to perfectly match your style. Come experience the all-new Fiat 500X at Fiat of Huntsville or online at fiatusaofhuntsville.com, a Frank Williams dealership.
At College Tire Company, your valuable wheels are safe because our new touchless tire changer protects your wheels during tire removal and installation. The machine never touches the wheel, and the new force balancer match balances your wheel and tire for a vibration-free ride. Buy virtually new name brand tires and you'll get free rotation for the life of the tire at College Tire Company. With two locations to serve you better, in Huntsville, call 489-7110. In Hansville, call 352-2221.
At Premier Bank, you have a financial partner you can depend on. Hi, I'm Jay Mullins, president of Premier Bank, with some exciting news about our financial strength and performance. For the sixth consecutive year, our bank has been rated 5 stars by Bauer Financial, an independent firm that has been analyzing and reporting on the financial condition of the nation's banking industry since 1983. This prestigious rating means that we are one of the strongest banks in the nation, and a safe and sound bank you can depend on.
Hey, everybody, and welcome back to On the Sidelines with Hagan and Hunter. I'm Seth Hagan.
I'm Hunter Price.
And we are back for our last segment of the day. Probably going to send you on to some NBA Finals basketball later on tonight. Golden State Warriors with a chance to end things at home, but Draymond Green is out for the game, so could be a matchup nightmare for them. We'll see, but we both said earlier on we expect the Golden State Warriors to be able to pull it out against LeBron James and company. But we left you guys with our top five in the way too early. We're in June 13th, for goodness sake.
I don't even think anything's changed.
I mean, but we're, wait,
the last
we're,
time we
we're
did
within
this.
Like 80 days,
hey, has,
right?
Has anything changed since
I love
the last
it,
time
baby.
We did this?
Football fever.
Nothing has changed since the last time we did this.
No, he released like another one.
I know, but nothing changed. It.
No, a couple things changed.
Did they?
TCU kind of moved up. And
okay, well, at number five,
yep.
The Oklahoma Sooners.
OU.
I don't see them being at number five at the end of the year.
I mean, they're losing a lot of guys, especially Eric Stryker. That guy made their defense tick. And if you know anything about Oklahoma, they don't usually have a good defense. So
I feel like
Stryker kind of changed their mentality a little bit.
Well, I feel like they've always kind of had a decent defense.
They're all right.
They've always had a hard nose.
Zach Sanchez is defensive end. Charles Tapper is gone. Dominique Alexander was pretty good.
Well, they're returning their backfield. They got Baker Mayfield at quarterback, Samaje Perine, and Joe Mixon returning at running back. But, I mean, I don't know.
Lost Sterling Shepard from that wide receiver core.
I guess it's a gut feeling.
Still
a
chance.
On Oklahoma, but I just don't see them being in the top 25.
Not as high. Not as high. I mean, they really kind of peaked last year, and then Clemson exposed them.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. Like, I mean, if they lose to Houston, then we'll know for sure.
Week one.
We'll know pretty soon about old Bobby's team. But
number four.
Moving to another Bobby's old team, Florida State Seminoles coming in at number four. Definitely lost some talent. Got to break in a new kicker after record setter Roberto Aguayo. He was awesome. Jalen Ramsey is gone, but really their main exodus of talent, I believe, was last year. So this may be a good spot for Florida State to step back in the ACC. Really only dealing with Clemson.
You're turning 11. You're returning all your stars on offense.
That's massive.
Yeah.
That's massive.
And probably maybe the second best running back, Dalvin Cook, right up there.
But the quarterback may change up somewhere in the middle of the season. I think DeAndre Francois will eventually overtake.
Is that how you pronounce it? Francois?
McGuire. Francois.
Francois.
DeAndre Francois.
Francois.
It's pretty smooth.
DeAndre Francois. Francois with the touchdown.
Yeah.
I think he takes over at some point. You
third,
think so?
Fourth game. Yeah.
Well, at number three, is this the year the Michigan Wolverines take up back the Big Ten? Can they do it?
We've been waiting a long time for the Wolverines to be relevant. We got a little taste last year, crushed the Gators in a lopsided bowl game last year, which really was indicative of the fact that Florida wasn't the same after their quarterback was gone. But Michigan, 14 returning starters, their kicker didn't lose too much. They will have to replace their starting quarterback, but I think Jim Harbaugh is a quarterback whisperer in his own right.
The one expected to take over quarterback
guy and gives him that confidence.
Houston transfer John O'Korn.
Oh wow,
John O'Korn.
Okay,
I don't like that name. That's a weird name.
It is kind of weird. O'Korn.
It's gonna be O'Korn. It's gonna be O'Korn or Wilton Speet. But
I don't think it'll matter in a Jim Harbaugh team. I think he's in the same breed as Nick Saban. I think it doesn't matter who quarterbacks
question, though,
his team.
Is
he's
Nick
just
Saban,
got so much great talent.
Is Nick Saban and John Harbaugh Are they worried too much? Are they going back and forth too much? I feel like they are.
They did go back and forth, but it kind of it got put to bed after a couple of back and forths. Yeah.
I just feel like there's too much drama going on, and they're not focused on what they really need to be focused on.
That's all Jim Harbaugh. He's just trying to get people looking at his program, and he's got a number three
or his belly
preseason ranking in his second year. That outdoes Gus Malzahn, and he was actually in the national championship his first year. So huge expectations.
At number two, a team that I think is 0-1 coming out of week one. And I really don't see them. I see them being top 10, top 15, but not number two.
The Clemson Tigers. They lost a lot on defense, man. A ton on defense. And I'm not saying that Clemson doesn't have the talent. Mm-hmm. They haven't amassed the talent to do it because they put people in the NFL every year. Clemson is just a good team year in, year out.
You got Deshaun Watson coming back.
But you're
losing Shaq Lawson.
Your secondary is blown apart.
You're losing Shaq Lawson.
Your defensive line is blown apart.
You're losing Mackenzie Alexander, who shut down Alabama when he was in the game.
Yeah. You're right. Only when he left did Alabama finally retake that lead. And
I don't think Alabama wins if Mackenzie Alexander doesn't get hurt.
He was fantastic. A guy that Auburn had a chance to get and actually got his brother, McEnroe, who later transferred.
To Clemson to be with, I think.
Really?
Yep. And at number one.
Happy trails.
Who else at number one? Is it Northwestern?
Is it North Dakota State?
Is it Arizona State?
Is it BYU? The Alabama Crimson Tide.
In a
yawner. Of course, they're number one. I mean, why wouldn't you? They reload every year. It doesn't matter who their quarterback is. They keep some great wide receivers. They may have the best wide receiver core in the SEC coming into the year. They've just amassed a bunch of wealth in Tuscaloosa, and until somebody knocks them off, they're going to remain there.
I think it's going to be interesting, though, with Alabama to see what they do at quarterback.
They always seem to lose a game, though.
So who's
the team that they lose to in the middle of the season?
I think they lose more than one this year.
So you think that somebody will knock them off?
No, I do. It depends what happens.
Is it LSU? Is it Ole Miss?
Depends what happens to Cam Robinson, especially at the quarterback position.
Yeah.
Because you're going to have two new running backs pretty much. And they're young guys. You're going to have trouble with the blocking scheme at running back. That's why Derrick Henry did not play as much his first 2 years. And that's just any running back at all is going to struggle with the blocking scheme. And if you take out the left tackle, that's 4 out of 5.
They're losing three out of five
on the offensive line. Yeah, without Cam,
Ryan
that's
Kelly.
4 out of 5 plus two new running backs. Do you go with the more mobile Blake Barnett or Jalen Hurts because of that?
I think you have no choice.
Or do you go with the sure thing in Cooper Bateman, even though he's not as mobile?
Boy, if he can't get out of there, I mean, USC, despite the fact that we just kind of knocked them down a couple pegs, they still have talent coming out of their ears.
Everybody's
going to be there that's good enough to beat a new Alabama offensive line. The question is, will Alabama even let them score? I mean, I think that
they're
is going to be a
they're losing,
huge type of game where you play the under.
They're losing.
Only going to be about 40 points combined.
They're only returning 5 on defense. Mm-hmm. And they're returning both their special teams, which I think hurts them.
It is what it is when it comes to the Alabama special teams. Don't get mad at us, Alabama fans. You know it's true.
You know it's true. Those field goals go everywhere except where they're supposed to go.
Yeah. And sometimes they get ran back.
And sometimes they go 109 yards. But
you never know. Anyway.
That is our way too early top 25.
And I want to throw in, because, I mean, hey, we're going with football. Why not? The Birmingham News released their SEC preseason look, and they got Vanderbilt number 14. Ho-hum, knew that. Vanderbilt's just, they're not that good. And unless they beat Kentucky, they'll continue to stay at the bottom. Kentucky at number 13, South Carolina at number 12. Pretty easy pick there. Notice that the SEC East's bottom three teams are the bottom three teams in the league. From there, it's Missouri, so that's 4 teams now in the East at the very bottom. No love there.
Mississippi State
finally comes in there at number 10. I think it's a pretty big consensus. They're just not going to be the same. I love Dan Mullen. I just don't think he's got the dogs to do it this year. And you're at the Bulldogs, so you need some dogs, naturally. Texas A&M, right after that. No surprise there.
They're number 9 in the AL dot, in the AL.com SEC rankings, but they're number 21 in the top 25.
Yeah, you're right.
Number 8, Arkansas. Number 7, Auburn.
Yep. So Auburn just above Arkansas there.
I think Auburn's going to really surprise some people this year.
I do too. It's really just because of injuries. Injuries, of course, uncertainty at the quarterback spot. But I just don't see Gus Malzahn putting out another bad offense.
Who's number 6?
Well, let's find out. Florida. Florida right after that. Luke Del Rio looked great in the spring game, but it is a spring game. I just think that now that Muschamp's boys are
gone, I think their defense takes a step back, and they may not do as well.
That's right. Jeremy Foley did step down. Athletics director oversaw the resurgence of the Florida programs, which oversaw several national championships.
He oversaw the resurgence, the downfall of the resurgence again, the downfall of the resurgence again. He was there for 25 years.
Yeah, I mean, he oversaw incredible.
He oversaw everything. He saw them go up, he saw them go down.
So many national championships, Florida basketball.
Who's number 5?
Basketball,
we got
football. Ole Miss. We already know how you feel about that.
Number 4.
But you got to think.
Georgia, I disagree. Number 3. LSU, I don't know. Here's number 2.
Who knows?
Tennessee, I agree.
Right.
Here's number 1.
You already know.
Alabama, I don't know. They could be, they could not be. It really, is this the year that things don't go their way?
Is this the year where, I mean, people were saying it last year, but is it? Is this the year where teams all lose multiple games? Do we have
an LSU type of
2007?
I think this might be.
We may be set up for that. I think the Big Ten champion will come out with just one loss or maybe no losses. I think Michigan's got a really good chance to go undefeated if they take advantage of the fact that Mississippi State and Ohio State lost a ton of starters. Good grief.
We had some. We had a champion this week before we close out.
Oh yeah.
The Pittsburgh Penguins. Closed out the Stanley Cup.
That's right.
Bringing it back
Lord
to Pittsburgh.
Lord Stanley's Cup.
Bringing it back, kissing it back to Pittsburgh.
Hey. And
Sidney Crosby winning his second. Their last one was in 2009. They beat the San Jose Sharks 4-2 in San Jose. Congrats to the Pittsburgh Penguins.
Yeah. Really, really great win. And a year where they had to beat a team that got hot at the end of the year in San Jose. But they made it happen. And shout out to Stanley.
To Stanley and his
and,
cup.
And Sidney.
And his cup.
Stanley and Sidney.
Said the kid. Yeah. Well, thanks for tuning in this week, guys.
Yeah, everybody. We'll be back same time next week, 7 to 8 here locally in Coleman, and 8 to 9 next week on Charter Channel 80 and AlabamaCableNetwork.com. Want to throw a little shout out in there to WUMP up in Huntsville. I am currently in a contest to have a radio show this coming fall on the weekend. So if you get a chance, head to umpsports.com. It'll be the very first page that they show. It's called the Kickstart Your Career Contest. So if you don't mind, click the link. Throw me a little vote. That would be nice. Anything for you, Hunter? Before we say goodbye to the people?
Have a great week. And don't forget, use the game. Don't let the game use you.